So when you are working on ECC, in ECC, someone is handling FI, someone is handling CO, someone is handling FSCM. So it's not like that here. So when you are coming to this one, S/4HANA Finance, or specifically S/4HANA Accounting, so you are going to handle everything. And when you are, our target is the migration. So when you are going to do the migration without having a good understanding on the previous system or the source system, it is very difficult to do the migration. So that's why I asked specifically how good you are in the controlling, specifically when you are coming to the broadcasting and profitability analysis. For example, I will go to in de detail. For example, let's say profitability analysis. Maybe earlier, if you have worked in the profitability analysis, so those concepts are completely changed here. So, for example, like if you have heard like control profitability analysis, there are two type of profitability analysis are there. Mostly, we are dependent on the costing-based profitability analysis, because by using the costing-based profitability analysis, we can have a cost splitting is possible, and we have all the data we can flow, whether it is a logistic document, whether it is a month-end controlling documents, everything we can transfer. That's why we are completely dependent on the costing-based profitability analysis. Whereas in S4, we are going to completely depend on the account-based. Or in fact, we can drop the costing-based profitability analysis also. And we are going to get all the features along with the COGS splitting, everything, we are going to get it from the account-based COPA. So that's why I asked how good you are in the controlling. But a good thing, like all are on the same platform, so I can do it this one in detail, or maybe from the scratch. Okay, so we will proceed. So this is the this is the discussion how we are going to move in the next 30 to 35 hours. What will be our agenda? Okay, what are the area we are going to focus? So here, like mostly I found like having good experience in the FI. So mostly like you are very good in the FI side and in the integration side. So here we will try save some time from here, and we will spend some time in the controlling side. But it's not like something mandatory we are going to follow the same, like as and when something is required, with that we are going to start or we will do it from the scratch. So let me give you, like if you are planning for the certification, let me give you first the idea what are the how you are going to focus from the certification point of view. Then I will come to my syllabus, and I will share with the calendar. Let me first share the certification. So you can see here this the phase whatever is open, it is related to certification point of view. So as for like from your feedback, I got I can understand maybe you all are eligible for the professional certification. So maybe you have already your SID is there, so that directly can go for the professional one. But anyway, cost point of view, there is no difference. You are going to pay $580 and you are going to get a 1 year validity. So even if you are not, if you think like I should not write the professional certification directly, you can go for the associate certification also. That is from costing point of view, it is not going to cost you more. Like if you go for associate, then professional or professional, so there is no difference. Only thing is that you are going to get 6 attempts, and from that 6 attempts, like how many attempts you are going to consume in different exams. So for example, if you go to if you are going to write the associate. Okay, I'm going to keep you in mute mode. But whenever you have any question, you just raise your hand. You can get one option, raise hand option. There you can raise hand option. Sorry, there you can raise your hands, and I will unmute you from my end. Okay, some background noise is there. So for example, let's say associate certification. How you are going to focus on the associate certification? Suppose you are, I'm not saying you should go for the associate certification, because as per your experience, you can directly go for the professional one. But if you are going to write the associate certification is whatever the business function was there in the ECC, same on HANA platform. So that's why if you'll see associate, you have to write two exams. One is your FI and one is your CO. So right now you can see this is the FI 1809, CO 1809 not yet released, like so far. As of today, it's not yet released. So here you can see all the normal asset like FI stuffs are there. Okay, normally your GL, AR, AP, asset, everything. But all this stuff on HANA platform, not on ECC platform. That means when we are talking about the GL, whatever the new innovations are there, it is there along with the old things. So it is associate certification they have designed. If someone is completely new and they want to start the career on SAP HANA or S4 HANA, so they need to focus on this one. So that is the purpose of writing the associate certification. Similarly, for controlling point of view also, you are going to find the similar options are there. Okay, so you need to write two exams, and here no migration. No migration stuff is there in the associate one, because expected these people are new, so they should settle them in the business process of your SAP and S/4HANA point of view. Our target, being experienced person, we should focus on the professional one. So this is the professional one. Okay, this is the code here, and here what you are going to focus and how we are going to proceed this one here. So if we analyze this particular course or the certification program. So why am certification? It's not only certification oriented. It will help you both certification as well as project and hands-on point of view. But as you know, right now certification is very important because it's authentication. Like, yes, you have the good knowledge on this particular product. And not earlier, it was very easy in USA, but now in India also, flexibilities are there. So definitely you should go for the certification. So although it is like only 49,000 something, the cost it will for you, and most of the cases your employer is going to reimburse also, but you should go for the certification because it will definitely give you the advantage, not only getting a job, it will give you good advantage when they will assign the project. So definitely you should plan for the certification also. So this one is your SAP S/4HANA Finance, or specifically here if you'll see, so what are the things are there? One is your SAP accounting, one is your SAP cash management, and one is your BPC. Our program is SAP accounting. So what is SAP accounting? So they are saying that you need to follow, if you'll check the books what you are going to refer. So the books, if you'll see here, like first one, the fundamentals, the architecture and all. So that's why they are saying that you need to focus on the S4F01. So what about the S4F01? S4F01 is your Delta F01. It is the Delta Finance. Delta Finance means you have already good understanding on the ECC, then you are going to have understanding, or you have like you will learn the S4 part, then what are the differences are there from the migration point of view, that you are going to add in the configuration and you are going to do the migration. So that is the concept of Delta. But this is the certification I'm giving. I'm not saying that we will follow the same pattern in the training. So then another one, S4F02, this is the Delta of CO or management accounting. Then S4F03, this is completely the migration process. Migration means preparation, customization, then your data migration, post migration. So complete migration will be there. From functional point of view, it is handled here. But when we'll go for the technical, like in migration topics, so that time we have to include the technical stuff also. Otherwise, we will not get a complete idea. Because when in like already, if you have worked on the migration project, you know very well, migration is not one person's activity. It is a complete team activity. Your role will be always there. Maybe you are a functional consultant, but you have to closely work with your technical people. So, but directly we will not jump with S4F01. You have to first complete this S4F00. So this is the new system, new architecture. From my side, I can say you should also go for S4H01, because F00, whatever they have given, it is just they have given from a functional point of view. Very few informations are there. Like maybe you can clear the exam from this by reading F00, you can clear the exam because questions are expected from that area. But when you are going to work on the project, you need some more understanding, because I faced the, like 5 years before when I came in this platform, I personally felt a lot of problems when lead to this, like lot of technical stuffs added here, right? So as a functional consultant, maybe we are not that comfortable in the technical side. So you should also go for S4H01 also. That is the architecture, the technical side. Okay, so this is your SAP accounting. CAS management certification not yet released, but like if in future it will be there, so it will be F40. And this is 80. Now, how we are going to proceed and what area you are going to focus. So already I shared my course content with you. I hope you have checked that. Just a second, let me open that also. Right, so this is the course content and this is the calendar we are going to follow. Initial some sessions, like you can see, we will understand the system, the new system very well, because functionally we are not, functional point of view, we are not that weak. We know how to do the system configuration. We are comfortable with the previous system. Okay, you just ignore the controlling part. Let's concentrate on the finance point of view. So we are comfortable. So that's why as a techno-functional consultant, we are going to focus on this part. Maybe you think like it's a theory part or something. Maybe I got to feedback this, like it's a theory concept, why we need to focus this much. But it is highly required, not only from your certification point of view, when we are going to involve in the project and when you are going to involve in the discussion. So that time, a lot of technical stuffs will be discussed during your migration and all. So that time, you should feel comfortable. Okay, what is this? Suppose someone is talking about the parallelization, and when your customer is going to ask you, what is this parallelization? So that time you are able to, maybe you are not going to write the program, but you should able to answer the, what is the concept. You should know what is this new technology. Okay, what is column store? What is the CDS view? So those things are highly required. So that is the reason now SAP, like when we are so you are going for the upgradation of your from ECC to S4. Like from your point of view, and also customer is going to their upgrade. So initially, so like 5-6 sessions, we are going to spend time on in this area. For example, let's say SAP in memory. So SAP in memory, maybe one word, or in if you check your material, you will find one paragraph is there. But the complete structure, HANA structure, is based on the in memory. So that's why it's not a word, or it's not a very small concept, right? So you know, it's, you have to understand the complete structure. And first we have to understand why this HANA came into the picture. What was the problem with this earlier situation? Maybe it is more from the point of certification. In certification, that detail may be not required, but when you are going to work and project, so whatever, whether it is a green field or it is a brown field, so in both aspects it is highly required. You have to understand your system very comfortably, and you should comfortable in all aspects. So that's why initial some sessions or some days we are going to spend time on this part. So this understanding the new system, and each word whatever is I have given here, or like I have extracted this one from the content, SAP content, it has some meaning, it has some concept, some logic, something is there. So it's not only for a this Now coming to migration, if we'll go to the system, I guess you have, you must have seen your system. Let me log into the system. You can note down your question. I will give the option. Let me complete my presentation. I will give you the option to ask your question. Otherwise, if you have any immediate question, quick question, you can also raise your hand. But better if something coming to your mind, just note it somewhere. So from tomorrow onwards, we are going to start the actual session. This is just a Q&A and the discussion. So if you go to the system, you can see the new navigations are there. So we should know how the new navigation, at which stage, what we are going to do, the new navigations will be there. For example, you can see here the conversion of accounting to S4HANA. This part I'm not going, because you, I know you are comfortable in this part. So financial accounting and controlling. So each step we are going to see here. Suppose this one, conversion, migration, right? So in this migration, when, let's say I am going to do the migration, what will be the process? First will be, there are some, like if you're going to follow the active methodology, you have some standard process is there that we are going to follow. Like for example, before doing the migration, I want my source system should it's ready for the migration. That means if something is missing, if new from the new technology, new feature point of view, if something is missing, then we need to add that from the customization point of view. And we need to complete the prerequisites. For example, a prerequisite, lot of features we are going to drop here. We are not going to use in the S4 systems. So those things we have to complete it here. Best example, for example, very frequently you are using the ABST2, the asset reconciliation with the GL. Those things are not required. So you need to complete that in the previous system and in the prerequisite stage. So like this, you have a lot of prerequisite activities which you need to complete in the source system. Then only you are going to do the migration. So that's why this step is known as your prerequisite phase, and it is known as your customizing phase also. Why it is customizing phase? Customizing phase means like if some configurations are missing, so then we need to adjust or we need to add that. For example, in GL configuration. So it depends what type of migration you are going to do, whether you are doing a migration from ECC 4.7 or ECC 6. That means whether you are migrating from classic GL or new GL. Accordingly, you are going to do the additional configurations. So that's why if you go to the GL, you won't get here the complete configuration. Why? Because in your source system, the previous configurations are there. That means I'm assuming that in previous configurations, you have the new GL implemented. So that means you have your leading ledgers are there, non-leading ledgers are there, accounting principles are there, everything is there. Only the additional features that you are going to add here. So here you are going to add the extension ledger, simulation ledger. So those stuff you are going to configure here. But in the training point of view, as I told, I have a mixed audience are there. Maybe here, luckily, like all people are good in the finance, but still for the better understanding, we will not start from here. First, we will complete the initial stuff, the understanding the new system. Then we will see the technical overview. There, basically, we will focus on the prerequisites. As a functional consultant or specifically as a finance consultant, what will be our role in the prerequisite stage? So there are a lot of activities are there. We have to do a lot of reconciliation. We have to extract some reports that we will keep for future data migration, post-migration purpose. So there we will compare. So we have some activities are there. So after completion of that, I will take a new company code and we will do end-to-end configurations are there. So that means I supposed to move from here, after completion prerequisite, I need to move from one by one from this step. But if I will only specify here, or if I will only specify myself here on this part, then some area maybe we will not add or we will not configure. For example, if you can see here, let me show you one screen. You are already comfortable in the OB22 screen where we are defining the currencies. Three currencies we are defining. One is your company code currency. I'm just randomly adding some points today. Okay, nothing systematically we are doing, just adding some difference to you. So here, this is the new screen where you are going to define all your leading ledger, non-leading ledger, simulation ledger, extension ledger, along with your currency. And currency, if you'll see 10 currencies are there, your accounting principle. So it is one consolidated screen you are going to get, or we are saying that this is the central currency settings. So if we will immediately start from here, maybe you are going to face the problem. So that's why we will take a new company code and we will add the complete configuration. But when we will do the complete configuration, it's not required online like in session. I need to do all the configuration. Those part is new for you that I'm going to focus here. Okay, so that's why from the beginning I asked about the controlling and you told we are not that much comfortable in the controlling. So controlling side, we will start from the scratch. You just leave it. From the FI side, for example, I no need to explain what is fiscal year variant and how we will do the configuration because it is the same concept, right? But related to the fiscal year variant, we have some point is that we need to highlight or that we need to discuss. You can see here. Check and adopt fiscal year variant. So if something is there that we need to discuss, I no need to explain you what is the posting period variant and how we are going to maintain and why we will maintain. Maybe not required. We know the configuration of OBBO and OB52. But if you go to the OB52 screen, you can see there is a difference is there. Let me open in a new session. Right. So as Controlling, there is nothing called controlling here. Controlling is merged with your finance, or specifically, if I will say universal general. So it is merged with that. Now you can see this is our OB52 screen. We are very comfortable on this part, but you can see a period 3 is added here. So we have some functionalities and some requirements are there. So that we need to focus, that we need to do the configuration. So that's why for my training point of view, I always start with a new company code and I used to do the all the configuration end to end. Okay, complete end to end configuration I used to do, so that whatever the new functionalities will come, that we can also see, not in theoretically, we can see the practically from the configuration point of view. So what are the new functionalities will be there? Let's topic wise, let's see. So this part, as I told, it is a new concept or new system. We are just going to hands off with our system and we are going to check our system or the new architecture, because we are very comfortable in the ECC segment. Now in this HANA point of view, lot of things are there. Like if you'll see, I heard like HANA something is there. So people are not differentiating what is HANA, what is simple finance, what is S4 HANA. For them everything is same. It's not like that, right? I hope you know the difference. HANA is something different. When we are talking about HANA, it's a database. When we are saying that it is the HANA appliance, it is something different. When we are talking about simple finance, it is something different. When we are talking S4 HANA finance or enterprise management suite, it is something different, right? So we should know all these fundamental things, right? It's not only we will just read one blog or we will read some document, it is enough. So that is not the purpose, and that is that. That's why here for the live training purpose. So we each and everything we are going to explore in detail and we will understand. Once we are comfortable that, then we are going to jump into the system. From the system point of view, if you'll go to any, let me show you any configuration. So I'm just showing my completed batch stuff. So here the complete configuration is there. That means here I have added my company code, my controlling area is there, my profitability and this operating concern is also there, my logistic point of view, whatever is required, that also I have added. I have added my plant, I have added my sales organization, I've added my purchase organization, right? Distribution channel, shipping point, division. So everything is there, because in each aspect, maybe I'm not saying that everything is new for you, but a lot of things are new for you, or in each segment something is there. For example, you are very comfortable in the outbound delivery, right? When you are doing the outbound delivery, there is one accounting document is generated and COGS account supposed to be debit. Here COGS account is debit, but immediately it is going to credit also. Why? Because now we are going to map COGS, that is your line item, GL line item, with your cost estimate, cost sheet, with your COPA. So that's why in each area you will find less or more, you are going to get some difference, and those things are new for us. We are going to spend some more time, or something we are new for that. For example, let's say cost calculation. So when we are going for a product cost calculation, so I need to touch everything. I can't skip here the cost center accounting. I can't skip the order management. I can't skip the activity types. So each and everything we need to include, because without that, I can't include the cost of production calculation. So that's why by default, everything should be included in my configuration, right? So that's why I used to do all the configurations, including some settings related to PP also, we are going to include here, or we are going to do this configuration. So from the my content point, I shared you the SAP certification. So this is the course content. You have to strictly follow for the certification, and you have to only read the SAP documents only. No need to read anything else. No market books from market, no my material, nothing is required, because 100% guarantee all your questions you are going to get from the SAP books only, and my question database, what I prepared on that aspect only I prepared. So that's why instead of wasting time here and there for to clear the certification, you have to only read these 4 books only, nothing else, right? That is from the certification point of view. But that certification document, already you know, as from the ECC experience, certification document is completely theory based. It will not help you do the hands-on or to understand this one. So that's why I will support you with my configuration document, or whatever the new document configuration documents are there, and we are going to do the hands-on or in system demonstration in the system in detail. So after completion of this new architecture and all, next we supposed to start from sorry, not this one, this one we supposed to start from here, the migration part. But as I told, if I will start from the migration, some part maybe I can I will overlook. So that's why instead of this one, I will come to here. But after completing, or once we are comfortable with all the new areas, new configurations, then we will back to here. First, we will do the technical overview of the migration. Maybe two to three sessions we will spend on that. Then after that, we will do the new configuration, right? Then we will do, for example, the GL. So GL point of view, I will do a complete new configurations. Maybe you are very good in the GL point of view. So, but I will assume that I need to start it from the scratch. So I will start with the GL concept, the leading ledger, non-leading ledger, all the parallel accounting, document splitting, everything we are going to do here. So maybe you will not find that much difference in your ECC and S4 system, but for a comfortable factor, we will do each and everything configuration in detail. So once you are comfortable in this area, then we are back to the migration once we will complete this part. Now, if we'll see what are the major key differences are there, or what are the like major difference are there. Major difference, if we'll see, we have something. Let me show you the table directly. You must be heard something universal general principle of one, or one single table, right? So whatever the old tables are there, like currently you are working on different tables, you are working some open item tables, lot of index tables you are working, right? You have like your GL point of view, BSIS, BSIS, BSID, BSID, you have your MLIT table, you have your custom vendor open item, Faggle Flex, whatever the tables are there, COEP, COSS, COSP, whatever the tables are there, everything we are not going to use it. It's not like delete it. It's there in the CDS view. Once I will explain the CDS view concept, that time we will see. But those tables are not active now, because now we are going to use one single table, that is the universal journal. Okay, so what is the universal journal? I'm going to spend two sessions for that universal journal. So in fact, we will start our discussion from 2011, not from HANA, from the moment SAP introduced this BWA. From that point of view, we are going to start our session, and step by step we are going to see the innovations. 2000, like if you'll see this diagram, you can see this is the SAP document, right? So no, officially if you'll see when SAP released S4HANA 2015, but actually this is the final product we got, S4HANA Finance, or S4HANA, but actually the process is started from the 2011. This concept of in memory applied on BWA, that is in 2011. So from that point of view, we are going to discuss. I will come to that. Let me explain this calendar first, then I will come to this one. Okay, so that's why if you'll see the date allocation, I have given more time towards this GL point of view. That means it is as a lot of new things are there. And second thing, when you know what is FI stuff you can handle, but now FI is not restricted with the FI. Or ledger, from the ECC point of view, we know how to create a chart of account, account group, master data creation, we can post the transaction, and some month-end activities are there, that's it. But it is not restricted that, your finance. Now your finance extended with Universal Journal, extended with all your overhead management. That means cost center accounting, order. These are now GL topics. These are not controlling topics. So order management, then you have cost calculation, product cost calculation. Everything is part of your now your GL. It's true. Maybe you are surprising, but it's true. Material ledger, everything. So universal journal includes everything. Okay. So the purpose is if you ask your users, what are the pain points in your source system? Two things they will give you the feedback. This system is slow because the concept of OLTP and OLAP. And second thing, we have a lot of month-end activities or reconciliations. So that's why here the purpose is bring everything, the best things in the world, bring in one place, or everything put it in the universal journal. So system is not going to generate multiple documents and there will be no reconciliation. For example, you posted one transaction with a cost object. Two document number is going to generate. One is FI document and one is your CO document. BSEC updated, COEP is also updated, right? If you're doing some month-end activity, then secondary cost, let's say you involve COSS also updated, COSP also involved in updated, then we have to do the month-end reconciliation. Now I'm saying all these things are not required, because when you are going to post a transaction with cost object, whether it is a FI transaction or even a logistic transaction, that means let's say material consumption, you did it, you issue the stock from the logistic, there also we got a document, and with that also let's say CO document is generated. Now there you are not going to get a CO document, there you are going to get a cryptic document. So that is a new concept, is there, cryptic document. Let me show you the document. I'm not specifying any document type, just run it. I took one document number here, some costs are here, okay, so cost objects are there, so you can see here some cost objects are there, okay, it's recorded with order, so cost objects are there. Now in ECC, when you are posting some transaction, you have a FI document and you have a CO document. FI document is correct, but no CO document. This document number, whatever is generated, it's a cryptic document. So which is auto-generated through the program. Why? We have a logic is there and we have a concept is there. We can't leave the CO balance sheet blank. So that's why it's an auto-generated number is generated. But somewhere you will find a CO document also. In this document, you can see there is no CO document, but somewhere you will find a CO document. Let me show you that document. No, this is a different one. Okay, you can see this is a one FI document. If I will give you the background, what is this document? This document is the after reconciliation document, right? So if you go to your accounting document, here you can see one FI document is there and one actual CO document is there, right? But what is the source document? If you go to the source document, the original document is the controlling document. That means in nutshell, if I will say, when you are working on ECC, your data flows from, you posted one FI transaction, data moved to CO, which you are using for your cost calculation purpose or your analytics, that means for profitability. These are the two things we are doing in the CO. So either you are going to include this in your cost calculation or you are going to include in the profitability analysis, that's it. But when you are going to do the month-end allocations, in controlling also, as we know, there is a new document generated or an internal document is generated. Now your FI data is something different. Your COE's data is something different. In the beginning of the month or during the month, your FI and CO both are balanced or matched. But in the month end, when we are doing the month end allocation, your FI is something different and your controlling is something different, because we did the allocations, we transferred all our costs to the production cost centers for the cost sheet preparation or cost estimate preparation. Now this cost centers are zero, or this cost objects are zero, because we transfer this cost to some other cost centers or some other cost object. Now that's why there is a mismatch in the FI record and CO record. But in S4, now your data is going to flow back to FI once again, CO to FI. So that's why I have given you two documents. In one document, there was no CO document, but in the second document, the data flow from CO to FI. So that's why definitely the source document will be there, CO. So in that case, cryptic concept is not there. So once we'll do the configuration, we will do one by one. So this is one important area. Major changes you will find, like one is, like cost of production calculation, of course, we are going to do that. But let me show you one important area. That is, okay, I suppose to show you the universal journal. The very famous AC dock table. Okay. Here it includes everything. I will just put the company code. Run it. So here you will find all documents, all transactions, everything. Okay. So this includes, you can see your business transactions are there. When you are posting the FI activity, FICO transactions, coins are there when you are doing something. So that means here you are going to get FI stuff, controlling stuff. I mean, when I'm saying controlling, it is not actually controlling, it is the universal journal, complete universal journal. So the management accounting stuff you are going to get here. Then you are going to get the asset. In asset also, those ANEA, ANEK, ANEP, those tables are gone. So you have only one table, that is your AC DOCA. That includes depreciation also. But although there is a one table is there, the FAT table is there, but mostly you will find the data in the universal journal. Your MLIT table gone, that material ledger information also you are going to get here. So whatever transaction coming to your mind and whatever the activity we are going to do in this system, everything is there in the universal journal. So this is our one source of table where we will take the information for the reporting purpose. And there is no separate total tables are there. You will not find the GLT0, you will not find the Faggle Flex also. There is no Faggle Flexer. For everything, this is the table we are going to refer here. So this is a vast area. Okay, in 5-10 minutes I can't able to explain. So that's why we are going to get the concept, universal journal concept, we are going to spend 2 sessions, and every day, end of the session, we are going to verify our settings or our impact in the universal journal. So whatever I told you, whatever we are going to do, everything is part of your universal journal. Now let me show you another interesting thing. You know, when you are posting the asset entry, what is the accounting entry? Asset is going to debit, vendor is going to credit. Asset debited and vendor credited. If asset value is 5,000, so this one is 5,000, right? Now here you have only one real depreciation. Whether you are working on the DHV7 or Classic GL, you have only one real depreciation. Other depreciations, if you are adding, that is only for the, let's say, for costing point of view, calculation point of view, I have added one depreciation area. Or let's say for your non-leading ledger point of view, if you have added one depreciation calculation purpose, you have added one. So that is not like your real depreciation. So real depreciation only one. And when we are posting the document, so I have the entry. Let me show you the EC system. This is EC system, okay? Oh my God, it's locked. Okay, so this is your asset entry. So we posted this entry. You can see what is the document type? Document type KR. So that means with this acquisition entry, although my GL entry, like this one, is posted, or my Asset Explorer updated with this value, but actually my asset documents not yet generated, or I can say my asset and the GL not yet balanced or not yet reconciled. Why? Because that's why we have to do the ABSD2. We have to, before period end, we have to do the reconciliation, and we need to transfer the value. So because it's, now you can see the document type KR. So you are doing this type of activity. Now same entry, let me show you in the S4 system. So that's why for each topic when we will do, I have a ACC configuration is there, and we will compare also. So let me show you the asset entry. So here, when we are posting the acquisition entry, the same, whether you are doing the acquisition through FDAS 90 or through purchase order, whatever. So you can see here, I can see at a glance, I can see here, what is the document type? The document type is AA. That means automated. Here we are saying that the reconciliation is by design. That means manually we are not going to do any reconciliation. It is automated. So you can see this one. If I will go to the asset document, here let me tell you the background. I have assigned here two accounting principles, because here we have we can assign the accounting principle. I have assigned two accounting principles, and with this accounting principle I have assigned the ledgers also. So 0L my leading ledger and N1 is my non-leading ledger. And when I posted this entry, due to as here multiple real depreciations are there, so multiple documents are generated. So let's go to this particular document. Now this is one entry which is the final entry. Normally what you are debiting first when you are going for asset acquisition, you are directly debiting your asset entry, I mean your APC account assets. Here we are not going to use APC account directly. Here we have a new concept is there, technical clearing account. The benefit is the ABST to dropped, not required. So the manual clearing not required. Due to the introduction of this technical clearing account configuration, once we will configure, after that whatever the transaction acquisition entries you are going to post, system is going to generate multiple documents. So here if I will go to the asset accounting view, now you can see here, this is my operation document. This is nothing but your ECC document. In ECC we have this type of document. So here when we used to post the transaction, your debit is asset 75, credit is 31, vendor, accounts payable. But here we have not debited, concentrate on this 2015. This is not my APC account. You can see, you can verify this one. This is not your APC account. If you'll see your APC, what was the account number? Yeah. So your APC accounts are 2010 and 11. So one is vehicle and one is building I have included here. But you can see here, when we are debiting, sorry, when we are first document. So document number, I'm talking about document number 15001. So this is my operation document, document type KR. When we are doing the asset acquisition entry, system is going to debit the technical clearing account. 2015 is my technical clearing account. With reference to this technical clearing account, the reference document, with reference to this technical clearing account, there is the asset document generated 10009. So here my technical clearing account, which was debited earlier, now it's credited minus, and your asset 2010 is debited. So automatically you can see document type double A is there. So operation document with reference to this asset document, and both the documents are part of your universal journal. Now this is on the basis of one accounting principle. If I will change the accounting principle, so which ledger we are using here? The leading ledger. If I will change the accounting principle, you can see here another document generated. Reference document is same, operation document. So with reference to this operation document, there is another document generated. Okay, so this one, sorry, this one, with reference to this document, there is another document generated. This is also asset entry, and here we have a different document number, because here different ledgers are assigned, different accounting principles wise. So that means we can say here we can monitor or we can capitalize our cost as per the accounting principle, because this happens. Like normally what happened, let's say as per your local GAAP, some costs are not included, but IFRS some costs are included. Let's say your taxes and you can't capitalize. So this type of restrictions are there. Now it is very easy. Let me show you the other transaction. So this is the beauty of your technical clearing account. So with reference to this technical clearing account, the manual reconciliations not required. Let me show you this entry. Now here asset value is 23,000. which we capitalized here. When I'm checking the accounting principle IFRS, I can see 23,000 completely capitalized. If I will change here my accounting principle, here I can see the capitalization cost is only 20,900. Balanced 1,900, this 1,900, I transferred it to one cost center. This is a cost center. Some 200 amount I transferred to HGL. So this is possible now. Accounting principle wise, we can segregate the cost. So this is some sample benefits of asset accounting. Here, lot of new features are added in this asset accounting. And when we will do the configuration, we will compare with the classic and with compare with the new GL. If you're comparing with the classic asset accounting, then a lot of 100%, like you will say, new stuffs are added. If you're comparing with the new EHP 7, then some features are also there in the EHP 7. So asset accounting, we will start it from the scratch. Just, and there is change in the depreciation program also. Now depreciation program changed, depreciation also, a lot of innovations are there. And here, everything is, we are trying to make our user comfortable. So that they like lot of efforts where they earlier they used to do the in the month end process or then the reconciliation, everything is now simplified. Okay, now coming to this F02 controlling, when we are talking about controlling, it is only COPA, nothing else. Maybe you can say management accounting is too vast, so many things are there. I agree. But from S4HANA finance point of view, controlling is only the profitability analysis. Because if you go to the migration point of view, so this one is your controlling migration. So controlling migration, you can see very few steps are there. It's just you are going to migrate your account-based COPA. That's it. And you are going to activate. So account-based COPA configuration in ECC system, because normally, as I told in the beginning, when you are working on ECC, we have a very weak account-based COPA configurations are there, because to get all the features, we have to always dependent on the costing-based COPA. So every company, they used to follow this one, and SAP also says that you should go for the costing-based COPA so that you will get multiple features. But here we have to follow the account-based COPA. So that's why we have to change our configurations in some extent, but this configuration again, very easy. So we will do a COPA configuration detail so that we have a complete comparison. Let me show you the COPA report. So I'm selecting here account-based COPA, my operating concern. So various line items are there, our document we have posted. Okay, so here you will find the documents, the logistic documents. So with reference to let's say we did the sales order, that also that transfer value we can transfer. We did the, because in ECC from outbound delivery, there is no update in the COPA. It will only update the accounting document. But here with reference to the outbound delivery, that is also, it is going to reflect here. Sales invoice, it is going to reflect here. Everything in the account-based COPA. So initially, if you have noticed, I have selected the account-based COPA. When you are going to do the month-end settlements related to your order or your cost centers, that also part of your account-based COPA. So we can say everything is part of now account-based COPA. And one important point here, let me go to, first let me show you the cost calculation. I don't remember the product name, I need to check. Whatever the data I'm showing, it is my previous batch configuration stuff. To 197, right. Okay, so this is how I calculated my cost, total my cost is calculated as 1748.14. This includes my direct cost, indirect cost, everything. So this is, I got the final output because I did all the configurations in backend and I run the cost sheet and I found it. And this price also updated in the material. I did the transactions and I have updated my logistic document also. And with reference to this, we have posted one outbound delivery. So we know the accounting entry, COGS is going to debit, FZ is going to credit. So let me select here the COGS account. Just ignore the entry, ignore this entry, these two entries ignore, okay? So this posting I did before my COPA configuration and COGS printing configuration. So when we did the delivery, this is the common like your ECC. So my original document is your outbound delivery document. This is my outbound delivery document. And with reference to this, I got a accounting document here. Nothing changes there. Okay, but you can see only one document. Other everything is cryptic document. CO is cryptic document. Material ledger is also cryptic document. Other than finance document, there will be no other document will be there. Okay, so this is my COGS debited and FG stock credited. Nothing new here. Let me show you after configuration document. So when we did the delivery, system is going to generate two documents. You just compare these two documents, 49003 and 49005. Here in this report, it will not show. Just for your update, right now, maybe you are thinking BSEG is there or not. BSEG is there. Still, we are continuing BSEG only for entry view. But for GL view, we are dependent on ACTOCA. And like any, there are a couple of documents will be generated, which will only update in the ACTOCA. That means there will be no entry view. So maybe in next versions onwards, or maybe they will drop it definitely BSEG. But as of today, it is there. BSEG. Okay, so here you can see we will compare the document number 49003 49004 when we posted 27th April. Let me take the date. So already we have seen the cost calculation. Our cost is calculated 174814, and for easy understanding, I have posted here one outbound delivery so that this cost is recorded. The moment you are going to do the outbound delivery, this document will be generated, 1748. Nothing new here. So your COGS amount debited and FG stock credited. Immediately, system is going to credit the COGS account. Here the purpose is how you have calculated your cost. The same should reflect in your P&L. Normally what happened in income statement, we will include the COGS amount, 5,000 or whatever. But what is COGS? This includes various cost components. If you need a bifurcation, again, we are saying that you have to go to the cost estimate, which is there in the controlling. Otherwise, here you are going to get the income statement point of view. We need the same COGS amount. So here, maybe impact point of view, there is no difference. That means profit will be same in both case. But now we have a better visibility, or we have a better clarity is there. So now how my cost is bifurcated here in cost estimate, same is reflecting here in my COGS. Let me include some more accounts. Now you can understand this one. Okay, just have a look here. I just added some more cost components to, these are my accounts. Okay, line item, GL line item, 26, 27, 028, and 1029. So with reference to the target document, that means one document 49003, where we debited the COGS account, 49004, where we credited the COGS account, and immediately you have the other components are there. Now, if I will prepare the trial balance, in my trial balance, I have my other cost components are there. So this is my material cost, setup cost, assemble cost, X, Y, Z, whatever the costs are there. So everything I'm going to include my income statement because this is zero line item. So I told you we are going to do the three matching. One is your cost estimate. It is there. Then in zero line item. So like, for example, let's take one document. So what is my material cost in my cost estimate or cost sheet? Material cost, you can see the total material cost if you include. Let me. So what is your material cost? Material cost is 1585.00. Now you see here 1585.12. Some more costs are there because some overheads are also there. Material overheads are there. So all total it is there. So that means how we have calculated your cost estimate, same is there. For example, setup cost, it's showing 0.25. Setup cost 0.25. So how you have calculated your cost estimate, same is reflecting your GLI. We are not restricted here. Now same should be reflected in your COPA also. Let's go to the profitability analysis. You check this document. So there is a, what is your COGS account? COGS account is 1015. So COGS account first, it is debited and it's immediately credited. This is debited. What is the document number? Document number with the source document. If you'll see the FI document, you can see here. This is the source document number. Then there is a new entry posted, it's credited, and you have the bifurcated of cost 1024, 25, 26, 27. Same is there in the GL. So this is a very new unique feature, COGS splitting. COGS splitting earlier it was there in ECC, it was there, but it was there within the controlling, and for this we have a lot of additional configurations we have to, and it is only restricted with the CO only. But now, and this configuration we are doing in the accounting, not in the CO. Right. So, and this is possible if you have an account-based COPA. If you don't have an account-based COPA, it is not going to work. So I've just highlighted some major areas. Okay. If I missed anything, let me check here. So of course, when we are going to do this one, so we have to do the complete integration part also we have to cover. But as you told, you all are comfortable in that. So I will do it at my end. Okay. So the major, like if you'll see, what are the important topics? Initial topics, as per me, these are very important. Then migration is fully very important because it is new for all, right? This migration stuff is also very important. Then from GL point of view, we'll see, like here you will find each area. For example, previously you have the cost element, right? K01, K06. So you are not going to create those cost elements anymore. If I will enter a K01, you can see where it is redirecting. It's redirected to GL. So that means it is merged with the account. If I will enter here K06, that is the secondary cost element, that is also merged with the GL. So even now we can say chart your secondary cost of secondary cost elements we have included in the chart of accounts. So that is merged with your, the GL concept is includes also the cost elements and all. Okay, then what else? Okay, here in the receivable payable point of view, not much changes are there, but now the business partner concept we are going to include, and business partner is nothing new. Earlier in the CRM and FSCM it was there, so same concept is introduced here. That means when you are creating a master data, for example, let's say XD01, so if you'll enter XD01, it is redirected to BP. So BP configurations are required. Suppose I will enter here XD01, check, XD01 is obsolete now, and it is redirecting to BP. So this is again the new concept, business partner. Fine. And business partner we will include in this one, but it is not there in your certification because it is handled by the logistic consultant. So this business partner, but we will do the CVI tool also we are going to do, although it is not there in your content, but we will do, so that you will have a understanding about this migration also. Asset accounting I already explained. This one is also management accounting controlling, given some idea, and also we are going to do this one. Okay, central finance, a different program, but 4 hours I'm going to spend on this also, central finance, so that at least you have some idea about the central finance. Okay, and when you are going to get the access, you have, this is your on-premises access, so you are going to get the Fiori access as well. So transactions, everything we are going to post it from the Fiori. Suppose you know how to post a GL entry, the same I can post it from the Fiori. So Fiori, let me log in. So in training environment, this is a little bit slow, but still we will post our transactions and we will do all the user activities in Fury also. Okay, so here, Fury, this is like you will find the applications. This is my dashboard and different apps will be there. And as per my requirement, I can use any apps. Okay, so it is completely user like new user experience. That means normally what happened in ECC, one T code is activated, it is activated for all. But here we are activating the role, and different role wise we are going to design. That means maybe we both are working on receivable, but you are doing something different and I am doing something different. So in that case, we are going to design, or we are going to like technical people, they are going to design this launchpad, and they are going to design these apps. And as per the user requirement, it can be customized. So here only the user activities you can perform. Master data you can create, transactions you can post, documents you can view here, reports you can get. So these are the like benefits of your Fury apps. Okay, so here also we are going to work. And one more option is there. That is again both is the cloud only. This is the cloud and that is also cloud. It is the same. Like let's say I like we two users are there. Maybe you have access to Fury. You can access it somewhere like from your tab, mobile, anywhere. You just download the app and you can use it. I don't have the Fury access. So in that case, but I have given the cloud access. So we can go for the web-based UI. That is the web info. We can go for that also. Okay, so this access also you can get. It is the same. Like what functions we can do from Fury, same activities we can perform here. Like you can see, that means user Pradeep is assigned. These are the different roles. So I can also perform these activities from my this NetWeaver. That is the same. Both are the same only. So these are different activities. Just if I want to do something, I will add it. If something is not there, so I can ask the technical persons, you need to activate this one. Once it will be activated, then I can work this one. This is just nothing but once you will click here, a new launchpad will be open and I can perform this one. So that is also one more access. But Fury and these are both. Bo basically, when we are saying that hybrid system is a combination of in deployment session, I will give more detail. Hybrid is a combination of on-premises and cloud, because some customers initially, like they are in the on-premises. Once SAP release the cloud, they move to the, some customers are there only in the cloud. The cloud, some benefits are there and disadvantages are there. If some customer is there in the cloud, they don't have access to IMG. Complete configuration handled by SAP. So that's why later they realize that it is very like costly, because initially in cloud you are just going to pay the subscription charges and you can use it. But whatever the developments will be there, everything will be chargeable because SAP is going to handle that. And second thing, data security, because even if you are going for a private cloud also and dedicated firewalls are there, still data risk is there. So that's why the most popular one is the hybrid system. And nowadays all the customers, previously there were they are in the cloud, now moving to the hybrid. Okay, so in nutshell, I have given some idea. I hope you got some idea. So from tomorrow we are going to start the actual session, and this is one by one we are going to start. Now whatever you have question, you can ask me. Let me